Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions. And the first portfolio questions is health and social care. If a member wishes to seek to ask a supplementary, they should please press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letter R in the chat function. As ever, I would appreciate short and succinct questions and answers to match. Question number one, John Mason.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the impact of minimum unit pricing of alcohol.
Minister Marie Todd.
Public Health Scotland are leading a comprehensive evaluation of the impact of minimum unit pricing of alcohol, details of which can be found on their website. The evaluation is over a five-year period and a final report will be produced in 2023. The evaluation covers the impact of minimum unit pricing in four outcome areas: implementation and compliance, alcoholic drinks industry, consumption, and health and social harms. As the evaluation is ongoing, it would be premature to draw conclusions on the findings of the reports that have been published by Public Health Scotland so far.
John Mason.
I thank the Minister for that reply. Some charities have been calling for a 65p unit price. Does the Government think that's a possibility?
Minister.
It is ongoing on the level of the minimum unit price, and that is underway. It is really important that that work is carried out thoroughly to ensure that any change to the level has a robust evidence base. Now, we know that the pandemic has changed drinking behaviour, and no more so than for those who were already drinking heavily before the pandemic. And there is more work to be done to better understand the continuing impact of the pandemic on alcohol harm. This is much wider than the impact on MUP, as it also encompasses the impact on treatment and support services. It's too early to know whether the changed drinking behaviours during the pandemic are temporary or not, and that will be relevant for the review of the price. And with regards to reviewing the level of MUP, it's currently too early in the process to make a decision on what that might be set at and when that might happen. The legislative procedure to change the minimum unit price is an affirmative Scottish statutory instrument, and the member will know that that means a detailed level of scrutiny. And it's really important that we take the time to get this right. So there'll be a full public consultation on this. And I'll provide more detail on timings once officials have worked through those details.
And supplementary, Paul O'Keefe.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Many people and organisations, including these benches, have called for a social responsibility levy to tackle problems related to alcohol and drug misuse. And yet the powers included in the Alcohol Scotland Act haven't been used in this regard. I met with Alcohol Focus last week, who have called for further work to explore what can be done to ensure that money raised through initiatives like minimum unit pricing can be spent not by the producers, but actually in terms of health interventions. So what further action is the Government taking in this regard?
Minister.
So the member will be aware we have a number of actions that we've already achieved, and minimum unit pricing is one policy, but there have been a number of other things that we've done. We've lowered the drink drive limit, we've introduced the multi-buy discount ban, increased alcohol brief interventions, and we're evaluating all of these policy interventions at the moment. As I said, there has been a significant change in drinking behaviour during the course of the pandemic, and I think we need to try to interrogate that and understand it better whilst we are also evaluating all these other measures that we've taken in order to find a way forward. What I do absolutely agree with the member on is that Scotland, whilst we have done a lot of work over the years to tackle that unhealthy relationship that we have with alcohol, it is still a significant problem for us, with that first year of the pandemic showing 23 people a week dying of directly alcohol-related deaths. So there is much more work to be done, and I am willing to consider all options.
Question number two, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports of long waiting times for women's health screening in Glasgow.
Minister Marie Todd.
So, following the temporary suspension of all adult screening programmes in March 2020 due to COVID-19, they've since resumed safely and in a phased way that initially prioritised higher-risk screening participants. The Scottish Breast Screening Programme has worked to increase screening capacity, including through the deployment of additional mobile units, as well as additional appointments at evenings and weekends. Recently published annual statistics showed that uptake in the recommended age range of 50 to 70 has exceeded pre-COVID levels, rising to 75.1%, which is above the 70% performance target. With respect to cervical screening, participants in the non-routine, that's the higher risk pathway, are receiving screening invitations at the same time as they would have done pre-COVID. Those on the routine pathway now receive invitations up to around 6 months later than they would have done pre-COVID, and the programme will continue to monitor that and look for opportunities to improve it.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The most recent available data shows that more than two-thirds of people are waiting more than 12 weeks for gynaecology appointments beyond the treatment time guarantee, and almost 60% are being left to wait even longer, 16 weeks for some, and we don't know how much longer beyond that. Does the Minister think it is acceptable for women to wait so long? Will the Government publish more data on women who have waited beyond 16 weeks, and will they set out what they are going to do to support health boards to reduce waiting times?
Minister.
So this does stray into, away from the territory of screening into the territory of diagnostics. The screening programme has recovered well from its pause, I would have to say, but the entire NHS system is still suffering the impact of a pandemic, which we are still coping with on a daily basis. I'm aware that some NHS health boards are experiencing longer than usual waiting times for procedures such as colposcopies. I know that's concerning, but we are regularly reviewing waiting lists. Clinical experts are involved in that assessment to make sure that people are seen as early as possible according to their risk. And in recognition of the challenges faced by health boards, we've agreed additional funding to address capacity challenges and increased waiting times in colposcoscopy. And we're more than happy, I mean, we are doing that as part of the NHS recovery for all other fields as well.
And supplementary, Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Leading health charities have in recent days called on the SNP Green Government to urgently appoint a women's health champion, as promised last August. There's no time to lose, which is why I'm extremely concerned this appointment may not be made for another 2 years. Can the Minister tell us in black and white when exactly this role will be established so that women can access the health care and treatment we deserve?
Minister, before you answer, obviously the question, just to repeat the lead question, was to ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports of long waiting times for women's health screening in Glasgow. So the supplementary obviously is well wide of that. However, I appreciate the supplementary has now been asked, and if the Minister wishes to make a short response to that, that would be up to the Minister.
I can make a very short response. When we set out the Women's Health Plan, the appointment of those women's champions was a medium-term ambition, and we are absolutely on schedule to achieve that within the timescales that we set out in the plan.
Question number three, Monica Lennon.
To ask the Scottish Government when the scoping exercise into the availability of specialist services within NHS boards for miscarriage and unexpected pregnancy complications will be completed.
Minister Marie Todd.
All NHS boards have been contacted in relation to the scoping exercise into the availability of specialist services within NHS boards for miscarriage and unexpected pregnancy complications. A lead professional for each board has been appointed. The scoping questionnaire will be sent to all NHS boards by the end of this month, and the deadline for all completed responses is the end of June. The results will be then analysed over the course of the summer.
Monica Lennon.
I appreciate the update from the Minister. It's been 3 months since we met with my constituent Louise Caldwell to discuss that progress. So I'm a bit concerned that the questionnaire hasn't gone out yet, but hopefully that work will complete by June. Is the Minister confident that the Government's promises to have compassionate miscarriage services in place in every health board will be in place by the end of 2023 as promised? And will she join me again in paying tribute to Louise Caldwell, who single-handedly has brought this matter to the Parliament's attention and is in touch with thousands of women in Scotland who need this action to happen now. Thank you.
Minister.
So certainly I will join you in your tribute to Ms Caldwell. It's one of the incredible privileges of this job that we meet people at the most difficult of times in their lives, and that they use those experiences to improve things for people who come after them. And Ms Caldwell is in exactly that category. It was a privilege and a pleasure to meet with her, and I know that my officials have been in ongoing contact with her. With regards to the timescales, I mean, it is very, very difficult at the moment to be absolutely certain. We don't know what's going to happen with the pandemic over the course of the summer, over the course of the winter, and over the course of the next year. But our intention is certainly to stick to the original timescales, if we possibly can, as much as is practicable.
A supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Preeclampsia affects 6% of pregnancies, which, if undetected, can prove fatal for mother and child. The National Institute for Health and Care Excellence recommendation that the NHS carry out 4 simple placental growth factor tests to positive diagnose preeclampsia. However, previous scoping has identified a potential issue with the suitability of laboratory services and facilities in Scotland. Will the Scottish Government commit to resolving this as soon as possible so that expectant mothers in Scotland can also be offered these crucial tests so they can have their babies in safety?
Minister.
So I'm grateful to the member for highlighting the importance of early intervention in the diagnosis and treatment of preeclampsia. I understand exactly how worrying pregnancy-related complications can be for women and for their loved ones, and we're committed to ensuring that all women receive high-quality, safe maternity care. As the member knows, we've tasked the Scottish Perinatal Network with examining the adoption of placental growth factor testing for preeclampsia in Scotland following the draft NICE guidance, which was published for consultation in March this year. This draft guidance includes 2 further placental growth factor tests, taking the total tests available to 4, and the network's first step will be to understand how these additional tests are conducted in practical terms and identify if there are any challenges to implementation. Work's underway in this, and I've been more than happy to write to the member to provide an update following the further scoping activity.
Question number 4, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to address any mental health and wellbeing issues arising from people experiencing loneliness in part due to restrictions due to the COVID-19 pandemic.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government recognises that social isolation and loneliness are public health issues which have been exacerbated by the pandemic and associated restrictions. We issued a wide range of advice on maintaining positive mental well-being during the pandemic, for example, through our Clear Your Head campaign and on the NHS Inform website. On the 7th of May, I announced £15 million for year 2 of the Community's Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund for adults. This follows on from £21 million provided in 21-22, which supports small-scale community projects to improve mental health and wellbeing issues such as social isolation and loneliness. And the Government is also investing £10 million over the course of this Parliament to tackle social isolation and loneliness more broadly. £1 million of that funding has been allocated for immediate work by organisations tackling social isolation and loneliness, including helplines, befriending and practical support.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Minister for his very full answer. Given the significant impact on the mental health of older people in particular, many of whom were isolated for long periods during COVID, they're now even more isolated and stressed as they struggle on their pensions to cope with 9% rise in inflation. Does the Minister agree it's high time the Tory government took immediate action to raise the state pension and ensure that those 40% who don't claim pension credit do get it? Does the Minister agree with me then that that would certainly help improve their mental health and wellbeing?
Minister.
I absolutely agree with Christine Graham, Presiding Officer. It's well past time that the UK Government brought forward an emergency budget to protect the most vulnerable people in our society, not least our pensioners. Of course, Presiding Officer, rumours abound that in the face of the crisis that centres on number 10 over the Sue Gray Party report released earlier today, that the UK Government might tomorrow finally take some action. Time will tell, of course, whether that actually happens or whether any announcement is remotely sufficient. It is time for the UK Government to take cognizance of the real difficulties that people are having during this cost of living crisis and the impact that that's having on their mental health and wellbeing.
Supplementary, Karen Mochen.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Although the pandemic undoubtedly exacerbated feelings of loneliness and isolation amongst much of the population, for many, a huge benefit to both physical and mental health was the ability to access and use green space. Given we know that a consequence of this government's poor record on health inequalities is fewer people from our most deprived areas visiting the outdoors regularly than the least, can the Minister update Parliament on cross-department Scottish Government plans to make outdoor space accessible to all and close the gap in use between our most and our least deprived communities?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I am very well aware of the value of green spaces in our communities and how beneficial they have been for people during the course of the pandemic period in particular. And as a former planning minister, I can assure Ms Mochan that there is cross-government work on these issues, and I'm quite sure that Ms Mochan and others in the Chamber will be cognisant of our plans for 20-minute neighbourhoods and to ensure that local people have a say in their own neighbourhoods through local place plans. And I'm quite sure that the public will make their views known about the valuable role that green spaces have in our society.
And supplementary, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister outline what support is available specifically for rural communities, such as those in the North East, where specialist mental health facilities might not be available locally and accessible public transport connections are not sufficient or available to enable people to easily access services elsewhere?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, although there are many, many positives about rural life, we also recognise that there can be challenges relating to rural isolation. These may be increasingly felt by those in remote communities as a result of the pandemic. And in partnership with the National Rural Mental Health Forum, we are working to ensure that these communities have equal and timely access to mental health support and services. And our Community Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund for Adults has provided support for projects which tackle social isolation across our country, including in rural communities.
Question number 5, withdrawn. Question number 6, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what recent assessment it has made of delayed discharge in NHS Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
We are constantly and closely monitoring the delayed discharge position throughout through the collection of daily management information received from health and social care partnerships right across the country. I'm continuing to meet with selected health boards and their local authority and partnership colleagues alongside the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care. We meet regularly to discuss issues and actions taken to address these delays. Health and social care partnerships are fully committed to reducing delays and continue to work tirelessly to support hospital discharges. However, the whole health and social care system remains under significant pressure, and more people coming through hospitals who need high levels of care and support to go home. Our Discharge Without Delay improvement programme, backed by £5 million of funding, continues to progress across Scotland with the key aim of improving patient flow through and discharge from hospital.
Craig Hoy.
In February 2015, the then Health Secretary said that she wanted, and I quote, to eradicate delayed discharge out of the system. Yet 7 years on, and the situation is worse and not better. In fact, since this failed promise was made, over 10,000 years, yes, 10,000 years worth of delayed days spent in hospital by people who were ready to go home. Does it remain this government's aim to eradicate delayed discharge? And if so, by when?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would gently point out to Craig Hoy that something quite significant has happened since 2015 over the last couple of years, which has exacerbated the pressures on social care and, of course, on acute sites, and that is the pandemic. And that's not just in Scotland, of course. That is happening right across health systems and social care systems across the UK. In fact, for example, I know in England the rate of delayed discharge is double what it is here in Scotland.
Absolutely.
Per head.
Double.
So that is just an example, almost double. So that is an example simply to point to the fact that these issues of the pandemic affect health services right across the country. So we'll continue to invest. I've announced over £300 million to help with winter pressures. A significant proportion of that, of course, funding, recurring funding, much of that recurring funding went into the issue of social care and improving the situation around delayed discharge. Delayed discharges are far too high. So we'll continue to take action to reduce delayed discharges. Of course, we want to get to a position where nobody, of course, is delayed in our hospitals for any longer. So we'll continue to do and make that investment, and I'll leave Craig Hoy not to come out with any solutions, but to grumble from a sedentary position. Yeah.
Supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I hope not to grumble from a sedentary position. Nicola Sturgeon became First Minister 7.5 years ago, £960 million has been wasted on delayed discharge. Now, I acknowledge that the Cabinet Secretary has provided additional funding, but it was some time ago, and it doesn't seem to be working because delayed discharge is still going in the wrong direction. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary when he expects to see improvement and when delayed discharge will be ended, Or is it going to be another abandoned promise?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, again, we will continue to work hard to reduce delayed discharge. If it wasn't for that funding, I can promise Jackie Bailey the situation would have been far worse than it currently is. In fact, I would say that in March of this year, the total delays in Scotland were 1,836. The latest figures, of course, will show and do show an improvement on that picture. Still far too high. That's where Jackie Bailey and I do not disagree. The situation around delayed discharges are far too high. But there is not a panacea, there is not a simple solution to this. Otherwise, governments right across the United Kingdom, I suspect, including in Labour-run Wales, would have figured this out by now. So we are working hard to invest in social care. That's why we've, for example, given funding to increase the pay for adult social care workers in Scotland. That will be part of the solution. So we'll continue to invest, and of course I hope that we'll continue to see the trajectory of delayed discharges move in the right direction.
And supplementary, Willie Rennie.
This is another typical grand promise from the SNP that hasn't been delivered. It was to eradicate it completely, all gone. And that was long before the pandemic. So there's no point in the Minister pointing at England, pointing at the opposition, pointing at everybody else, when he's in charge of this policy and has failed to deliver it. It's not even making any progress. It's going backwards. When is the Government Minister going to accept that this has not been delivered, and when is he going to deliver a policy that does actually work?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, what I would say is it's not going in the wrong direction, because I've just mentioned there that March 2022, March of this year, we had 1,836 delayed discharges. We're now at a figure that is below that, and I hope to continue to make progress in the right direction. Where Willie Rennie, Jackie Bailey, Craig Hoy and I probably all agree is that those numbers are still far too high. So we'll continue to invest, as I have done, with over £300 million of winter funding, much of that recurring, much of that money going into social care to help to provide solutions. And what I won't do is take lectures from a Liberal Democrat about broken promises.
Yeah.
Question number 7, Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what provision exists to provide an inpatient specialist dermatology service for patients in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Cabinet Secretary.
The requirement for inpatient dermatology bed provisions has significantly decreased over recent years, with a trend towards focusing on ambulatory care. Such a number of enhancements have been made to the ambulatory care services across NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde to reflect this trend. However, while inpatient dermatology admissions have fallen significantly, arrangements are in place to ensure that any patient who is clinically assessed as requiring inpatient treatment can still be admitted to hospital. Patients will be admitted to an inpatient medical bed and managed by the dermatology, medical and nursing team. As part of recovery plans and remobilisation, the speciality will continue to review the best provision of care going forward, although it should be noted that, regardless of this outcome, there will be a continuing commitment to meet patients' needs and expectations, including inpatient care for dermatology patients where clinically indicated.
Bob Dorris.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Unfortunately, the reality on the ground might be a wee bit different. NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde no longer have any dedicated inpatient dermatology beds. That means my constituent, who suffers from severe atopic eczema, has seen her quality of life, her work and her mental health dramatically deteriorate. The elimination of beds at the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, dedicated specialist beds, puts my constituent in a much inferior position for what is outpatient daycare at the GRI. I've asked the NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde to urgently review the provision of specialist dedicated beds. Will the Cabinet Secretary look at this as well, contact Greater Glasgow and Clyde and ask them to seriously consider the review that I am calling for?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'll of course have a conversation with Greater Glasgow and Clyde about the issue that Bob Dorris has raised. My understanding is that of any patient that is clinically assessed as needing inpatient care, that will be provided. If that's different to the experience that his constituent has experienced, then I would urge him to, of course, contact Greater Glasgow and Clyde, which it seems like he has done, but also if he wants to raise that issue with me, he's welcome to do so. It may not be appropriate to carve out speciality beds where the demand is relatively low, notwithstanding, of course, the impact that condition has on his constituent, but it should be the case that, of course, anybody who has that clinical need, if they are clinically assessed as needing that inpatient care, then that is managed and the speciality dermatology services are provided to them. But I'm happy to pick some of the detail off the table with Bob Dorris.
And supplementary, Sandish Gohani.
Bob Dorris makes a great point on how dermatology issues affect mental health and quality of life. And it's not just Bob Doris's constituent, but actually everyone. And dermatology has over 1 in 10 patients waiting over a year for an outpatient appointment. We know the use of images in referrals to dermatology departments speeds up the process. Only 5 health boards are using this system. Why is it not all of them, and why is this not already a national standard?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's a really important point made by Santosh Gohani on this. And, of course, I will work with health boards right up and down the country to make sure that we can speed and give pace to the use of technology. We saw that, of course, with the pandemic. It shouldn't have taken a pandemic to, for example, ensure that we had that video technology, for example, with near-me video technology when accessing GP services. So where we can increase the pace around the use of technology for dermatology services, I will make sure that conversation happens with every single health board about how we can quicken and speed up the pace of the use of that technology.
And question 8 has not been lodged, and that concludes portfolio questions on health and social care. And we will now move on to the next portfolio, allowing a brief pause for front bench teams to change positions if they wish. Thank you. The next portfolio is social justice, housing and local government. If a member wishes to seek to ask a supplementary question, they should please press their request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letter R in the chat function during the relevant question. Again, I make a plea for short and succinct questions and answers to match. Otherwise, I will not be able to take all questions. Question number 1, Russell Findlay.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether the reasonable period of time for households to install interlinked fire alarms in line with the new legislation has now passed.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
Thank you. This legislation improves fire safety and ensures the same level of protection applies to all homes. A reasonable period will depend on individual circumstances. That's why it's not defined in legislation, including in the case of the new fire alarms standard. The Scottish Government, in partnership with COSLA, published a statement on the 21st of January confirming that local authorities will take a proportionate and measured approach to compliance.
Russell Findlay.
Thank you for that answer. We have a law that came into force over 4 months ago. It was rushed through in defiance of warnings from these benches and from many others, yet we still don't have a date in which people risk being criminalised for non-compliance. Can the Cabinet Secretary commit to providing some form of date or guidance, and if not, even to give guidance as to when she might be able to do that on behalf of all the people who don't know what their situation is going to be? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, if Russell Findlay would have heard my first answer that said that a reasonable period depends on individual circumstances. It's not uncommon for that to be in legislation. It's not defined in other pieces of legislation, and it's not defined in the new fire alarms standard. What has been said by local authorities that obviously have the broad statutory responsibility for tackling substandard housing in their area is that they will take a light touch approach. But what is important, and it is disappointing that Russell Findlay portrayed the sort of defiance and opposition to this as being something of merit, when actually, if I could quote from Alistair Perry from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, he said, "Having the earliest possible warning of a fire in the home can and has saved lives and property. Having interlinked alarms installed will allow everyone, anywhere in the house, to take action as quickly as possible." Why would you want to oppose that and then make a virtue of opposing it? I just find that very difficult to understand.
Supplementary, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary is saying that the local authorities have the duty to enforce and uphold the new standard for fire alarm system. Can the Cabinet Secretary say whether all local authorities have enforced this standard for their own tenants?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I understand, there's a very high level of compliance by local authorities and RSLs for the new standard. I think there was a small number of properties still to be done, but their intention was to get to 100% as quickly as possible. But good progress had been made. Happy to write to Mark Griffin with the latest figures, if he would find that helpful.
Question number two, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the number of people facing eviction in the wake of the COVID-19 pandemic.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
The latest data show that eviction action by landlords in both the private and social rented sectors reduced significantly and remained low throughout the worst of the pandemic. Private sector evictions have recently started to return to pre-pandemic levels, and social rented sector cases remain substantially lower than pre-pandemic levels. We are committed to providing increased stability, quality and affordability in renting, and that's why we're taking forward reform through our New Deal for Tenants, including strengthened tenants' rights, rent controls and a new regulator for the private rented sector.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I would like to thank the Minister for that answer. In recent weeks, the Social Justice and Social Security Committee has heard evidence that sheriff's officers are making up for lost time since the pandemic. For local authorities, the committee has also heard that remarkable cost of the eviction process, an estimate of 24,000 for relatively simple cases, to evict people who must then be rehoused in temporary accommodation anyway. It is surely better for all involved to avoid this situation. What is the Scottish Government doing to minimise evictions and work with the local authorities and others to support people in danger of it?
Minister.
I'm grateful for the question. I share Mr Chowdhury's concern about this issue, and I hope that we all do. I think it would be overstating the case to say that people are making up for lost time. As I said, social rented sector evictions remain low compared with pre-pandemic levels. Private rented sector eviction actions have started to return to pre-pandemic levels, but are certainly not above those levels. In terms of the immediate action, as Mr Chowdhury will know, the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill includes putting two measures on a permanent footing that were introduced on a temporary basis, pre-action protocols for the private rented sector and making all repossession grounds discretionary, so that all of the circumstances of both the landlord and the tenant have to be taken into account. And I hope that's something that the Chamber will welcome.
And supplementary, Claire Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister welcome, as I do, that the measures which improved fairness in the private sector during the pandemic have been incorporated into Part 4 of the COVID Recovery and Reform Bill, ensuring a better balance between the rights of tenants and the rights of landlords? And does he welcome also that this move is supported by Shelter Scotland, Citizens Advice Scotland, Living Rent, Public Health Scotland and Police Scotland?
Minister.
Yes, indeed. As I said, I think the placing of these measures on a permanent basis is a very positive step. The wider proposal set out in our New Deal for Tenants consultation made clear the government's commitment to see improvements in the rented sector to ensure that people are treated fairly and can access good quality properties. So making these provisions permanent is an important step toward achieving that. All eviction grounds have been discretionary for council and housing association tenancies for 20 years. Therefore, these provisions also contribute to our aim of developing a more unified approach across all forms of renting, reducing the gap in outcomes between social and rented sector, recognising that housing, adequate housing, is a human right for all.
Question number three, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what the implications are for Social Security Scotland of the redeployment of staff to the agency from the DWP.
Minister Ben McPherson.
There are no current plans to redeploy any Department for Work and Pension staff to Social Security Scotland. Furthermore, since Social Security Scotland was created in 2018, no Department for Work and Pensions staff have been redeployed from the Department of Work and Pensions to Social Security Scotland.
Richard Leonard.
Thank the Minister for that reply, although I think it's quite shocking. The PCS Union, which represents these workers, has quite rightly mounted a campaign to save their jobs and avert these closures under the banner, first we were clapped, then we were scrapped. In November 2021, Boris Johnson went so far as to call them miracle workers. He might be in need of a miracle worker himself now that the Sue Gray report has been published. Last week, the Auditor General produced a report on Social Security Scotland. In it, he said, and I quote, and I hope the Minister will listen to this, timescales are challenging and substantial risks remain, including getting operational staffing in place. He spoke of a high and increased reliance on contractor staff of around 47%, driven mainly, he said, by ongoing challenges with recruiting staff with the relevant skills and experience needed.
Could we have a question, please, Mr Leonard?
So can the Minister reassure Parliament, and can he reassure those 64 DWP workers in Aberdeen and the 101 DWP workers in Kirkcaldy facing redundancy, that rather than sending the PACE team, the government will enter meaningful talks with the PCS and the DWP to transfer and redeploy these workers?
Minister.
Thank you. I think, first of all, I'm not a DWP minister, so I can't be accountable for the UK government's actions, as Mr Leonard will be aware. However, of course, we are recruiting significantly for Social Security Scotland as it scales up to continue to build on the significant achievements which were acknowledged in Audit Scotland's report as we continue to roll out new Scottish benefits and undertake significant case transfer. As of the 31st of December 2021, the agency Social Security Scotland employed over 1,900 staff, and the member will be aware that we expect to employ more than 3,500 full-time equivalent staff across Scotland by March 2023. And of course, that is open to everyone who would wish to apply for these vacancies. And indeed, since Audit Scotland undertook its investigation and analysis to prepare its important report, there has been further recruitment in that period up until now. So we continue to recruit. We have adequate staffing to serve the people of Scotland as things stand, and we look forward to welcoming more people to Social Security Scotland as we continue to take the devolved benefit programme forward.
And brief supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, President Officer. We all agree that the UK Government's decision to close 42 DWP offices and putting 1,100 jobs on the line is a staggering situation at a time of cost of living crisis. Does the Minister agree that the UK Government should rethink his plans and put hard-working staff and DWP service users first, categorically ruling out any further closures and redundancies?
Minister.
I do think that, and I should have acknowledged that in my answer to Mr Leonard as well as to Mr Kidd. Furthermore, Social Security Scotland has well-established links with Skills Development Scotland, who run the Partnership Action for Continuing Employment, which provides support for any large-scale redundancies if the UK Government do proceed, and of course we do not want them to undertake these closures. Social Security Scotland, as I've said, is also currently in the process of recruiting across a range of roles and will work with all relevant partners to understand the situation that has been raised by both members and actively promote our vacancies to anyone facing redundancy. Social Security Scotland has experience of working with other partners in the civil service with a view to supporting positive outcomes for people who find themselves facing redundancy while being appropriately diligent in our operations as well.
Question number four, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its assessment is of Social Security's efficiency in delivering benefits.
Minister Ben McPherson.
The Scottish Government has designed a Social Security system that is straightforward for people applying for benefits, either online or by other means that suit them best. Also, when considering disability benefit applications, we also aim to get decisions right first time, much more regularly than the DWP have, and this will reduce the need for lengthy and inefficient appeals processes. And a lot of thought has gone into improving our system in this regard when compared with the DWP. Lastly, it is also worth noting that in its client survey, 92% of respondents rated their overall experience of Social Security Scotland as very good or good. Building on that, the agency's operating costs when case transfer is complete will be comparable with the DWP's.
Jeremy Balfour.
hope the Minister is aware that there has been an issue as of late with incredibly slow processing times for many of the devolved benefits. For example, in January of this year, the average in processing time for the Best Start grant was 30 days, the highest ever. Can the Minister tell me how will we address the snail's pace of processing times?
Minister.
Well, first of all, I don't think Mr Balfour is accurate in his description of the agency's performance, in that I think that as the client survey has evidenced, the experience of people applying and dealing with the agency is very positive according to their feedback. Of course, we are always looking to improve our services, both the efficiency and the experience of clients and those using our services. For example, automating benefits is something that we're putting a lot of investment and thought into. For example, child winter heating assistance is already automated. Low-income winter heating assistance will be automated, and no one will have to reapply for our disability benefits. They will be automatically transferred from the DWP to Social Security Scotland. We are also going to automate two of our family payments, Best Start Grant Early Learning Payment and Best Start Grant School Age Payment, in line with the Scottish Child Payment, where we already have the information to do so. So there's a lot of work going in to continue to improve the system, but efficiency is already at the heart of everything we're doing.
Supplementary, Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As the Minister has mentioned, I also welcome Audit Scotland's report, which highlights the Scottish Government's significant achievement in the scale and pace of delivering these benefits. Can the Minister provide some more detail about what the Audit Scotland report says about the experience of those engaging with this new Social Security Scotland system?
Minister.
I would encourage all members to look at the report, which praises our approach to ensuring that it is people who help design our social security system every step of the way, and has been. And in regard to those who use our new Scottish social security system, the report states, and I quote, "There is a conscious focus on the needs of service users, building on the principles of dignity, fairness and respect. People are positive about their experiences of engaging with Social Security Scotland."
And supplementary, Willie Rennie.
Currently, there's only a few thousand cases for the adult disability payment, but it's due to rise quite fast in the next 5 years to almost 500,000 cases. People depend on this money. So when the ramp-up starts this summer, how confident is the Minister that everyone will get their money on time?
Minister.
I think these are Mr Rennie makes very important points around the scale-up as we go through the different phases of the pilot. And of course, we're in phase one, and there will be two further pilot phases before national rollout at the end of August. And that is why we are continuing to undertake recruitment and continue to refine our systems so that those who are applying receive a good service and a much better experience in the DWP as they go through the process of their application. And then also, we will initiate case transfer for adult disability payment from the 13th of June, and there are regulations before Parliament on that at the moment. And of course, that will begin the process of making sure that we deliver for those clients, both those applying and those who are being case transferred. And we are very focused on making sure that that's done safely and securely to serve the people of Scotland.
Question number five, withdrawn. Question number six, Pam Gozo.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the rollout of the social security benefits.
Minister Ben McPherson.
Social Security Scotland is delivering 12 benefits now, 7 of which are completely new forms of financial support not available elsewhere in the UK, and they are supporting low-income families, carers and disabled people. As Audit Scotland stated last week, this has been a significant achievement in challenging circumstances. Social Security Scotland is ensuring £3.9 billion worth in payments this year to reach around 1 million people, as well as preparing for further benefits due to be delivered and transferring around 700,000 cases from the DWP. And I will say more about this to Parliament in our debate tomorrow.
Pam Gozo.
I thank the Minister for that answer. A report from Audit Scotland last week forecasted that the adult disability payment caseload will increase from 20,000 cases in 2022-23 to 475,000 cases by 2026-27. Considering the numerous delays to the rollout of devolved benefits, can the Minister guarantee that the Scottish Government is fully equipped to respond to the rapidly increasing caseload?
Minister, I understand that you kind of dealt with that subject further to a supplementary raised by Mr Rennie, but if you feel you have anything further to add in light of the specific framing of the question, supplementary from Ms Gozo, please go ahead.
If I may, thank you, Presiding Officer. To elaborate on my first answer, I mean, the Audit Scotland report was complementary on what has been achieved so far in very challenging circumstances, including a pandemic. And Parliament should be mindful that during the pandemic, as well as the Scottish Government having to reprioritise resources and delay some of what we were doing, so did the UK Government. And actually, the delivery of devolved social security is a joint programme with the UK Government, DWP, HMRC and the Scotland Office. And when it comes to what we do next and what we still have to deliver, engagement between both governments is very important to doing that successfully, and we are very committed in a constructive manner to working with the UK Government as we do that and undertake case transfer. And actually, the fact that we've delivered 12 benefits, 7 of which are new, I think is remarkable progress, as is acknowledged in the Audit Scotland report, because we've introduced benefits that weren't in the programme when this Scottish Parliament passed the Social Security Act in 2018. So the progress has been significant, and I look forward to debating this tomorrow. Thank you.
And I can take two supplementaries if I have brief questions and brief answers to match. Co-Cab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Regarding the forthcoming rollout of adult disability benefit in Glasgow, I'm already hearing from my constituents who are welcoming the no requirement to reapply feature once it's been set up. Does the Minister agree with me that this provides reassurance and dignity to those in receipt of it?
Minister.
Yes, it does, and it stands in contrast to the UK Government's managed migration to universal credit, where people will need to reapply without any support. We will safely and securely transfer 700,000 adults and children from the DWP to Social Security Scotland, and that is already underway. And each and every one will be transferred automatically with no need whatsoever to reapply, and we will contact them about their transfer both before and after so that they are kept informed. This is a key part of our approach to adult disability payment, which also removes degrading DWP-style assessments, which so many disabled people told us they found distressing and intrusive.
A supplementary, Pam Duncan-Glassy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. What progress has the Government made developing a leaving fund for women fleeing domestic violence?
Minister.
I'm happy to consult with colleagues who are the ministers responsible for that area and supply an answer to Pam Duncan-Glassy in writing.
Question number 7, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to ask the Scottish Government what discussions the local government minister has had with local authorities regarding services to promote social wellbeing.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robinson.
I regularly meet representatives of local authorities and COSLA to discuss a wide range of issues as part of our commitment to working in partnership with local government to improve outcomes for the people of Scotland. We have a joint programme board with local government to oversee work to achieve the COVID recovery strategy, which has a fundamental focus on tackling inequalities and improving wellbeing for everyone in our communities. We're also working closely in the creation of our Child Poverty Action Plan and local delivery plans as part of our national mission to tackle child poverty.
Jim Fairley.
I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the emphasis placed on the holistic approach of social wellbeing by the newly elected SNP administration in Perth and Kinross is a positive and promising example of how local government can put the Scottish Government's vision of a wellbeing economy into practice at all levels and is suitably adapted to the needs of the local community?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I say I'm delighted that the new SNP administration in Perth and Kinross is embedding social wellbeing into their local approach. To support more local councils and regions to embed the wellbeing economy approach into their local strategies, we have committed to publishing a wellbeing economy framework, and I'm sure we'll have a lot to learn from Perth and Kinross, as will other councils.
Supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The decision by the SNP Green Government to cut over £250 million of council funding is clearly impacting on the ability to deliver local advice services. So can I ask, what assessment have ministers made of the loss of advice services, which are so important to our fellow citizens, especially probably in Perth and Kinross, where that might also face cuts?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we have increased funding to advice services from this government because we understand the importance of ensuring that people get access to the advice that they need, particularly in these times. But I would say to Miles Briggs, you know, it is a bit rich for Miles Briggs to talk about local government funding. We've delivered a 3.6% cash terms revenue budget increase to Scotland's councils between 2013 and 2020. Over that same period, English local authorities faced a cash terms revenue cut of 14.7%. The Local Government Association has just set out in the 2021 spending review submission that English councils have already dealt with a £15 billion real terms reduction to core government funding between 2010 and 2020. So Miles Briggs says one thing in opposition and then, of course, they do a completely different thing when they're in government.
And question number 8, Megan Gallagher.
To ask the Scottish Government how its housing strategy will support local authorities with developing dementia-friendly homes.
Cabinet Secretary.
As set out in Housing to 2040, our aim is for everyone to have a safe, high-quality home that is affordable and meets their needs in the place that they want to be. And that's why our Affordable Housing Supply Programme is already supporting the provision of dementia-friendly homes in communities across the country, where this is identified as a strategic priority by local authorities. And I give an example. North Lanarkshire Council recently completed 27 new homes at Caledonia Avenue, Bells Hill, using best practice principles for dementia design, backed by almost £1.6 million of Scottish Government investment.
Megan Gallagher.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. There are approximately 90,000 people living with dementia in Scotland, with roughly 20,000 people diagnosed each year. Due to SNP Council cuts, care and repair services have been reduced or scrapped in local authority areas, including North Lanarkshire Council, with others only providing a basic level of service to those who are living with dementia. Given the need for more dementia-friendly homes, does the Cabinet Secretary agree that care and repair services are essential so that people can live at home and independently for as long as possible? And does she also agree that by cutting local authority budgets, this impacts the most vulnerable in our communities?
Yeah. Cabinet Secretary.
Well, if Megan Gallagher had been listening to my previous answer, she would have heard what I said about local government funding in terms of the increase that we have given. Times are tough, and of course we have to, in a fixed budget, give a fair settlement to local government. We also have to fund social security benefits, and of course it was the Conservatives who supported the doubling of the Scottish child payment. So we have to balance all of these things. I'm not aware that the Conservatives came forward with any amendments to the budget asking for an increase in local government funding. I might be mistaken about that, but I don't think they did. But on the important issue of people with dementia, of course care and repair services are important, as is a range of services supporting people with dementia. But I did say to Megan Gallagher that we were funding directly through our Affordable Housing Supply Programme in North Lanarkshire Council, for example, the £1.6 million of Scottish Government investment to help make sure that the homes are fit for purpose for people with dementia. And that is something we are happy to do and support across other local authorities. So it's not factually correct to say that we're not investing in dementia services, because I've clearly demonstrated that we are.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice, housing and local government. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.